So what's next? I mean, memory is an important key function that's impaired. What about attention?
Attention interacts with the working memory system. So what happens is the challenges in attention are twofold. One is to attend to important information while ignoring irrelevant information. That's called selective attention. And the other is to sustain your attention and vigilance over time. So if you're listening to someone tell a story and it's a story that lasts 2 minutes, if you can't concentrate for 2 minutes, you'll never be able to encode the story. So it's those two things. People with schizophrenia show more distractibility and more challenges in sustaining attention than healthy people do. But it's not ADHD. There's a real difference between those two. Often people say, well, ADHD has attentional challenges. Yes, but what kids with ADHD, or adults now that we recognize they have it, what people with ADHD do is they tend to respond impulsively rather than not being able to sustain their vigilance. So if you ask them to listen to a 10-word word list, some of them may start responding back to the word list before you've read the whole list to them. And so they are responding rapidly before processing the information. People with schizophrenia tend to have a challenge in processing the information over the course of its presentation. So it's different.
I understand you do the CPT, the continuous performance test for attention. What is that like?
The continuous performance test is a very interesting test because it can measure both the attentional challenges in schizophrenia and in ADHD. So what the continuous performance test is it's continuous. There are streams of information presented. So in its most simple version, you look at a computer screen, and every second and a half, a single letter shows up. And in the simplest version, you instruct the person, every time you see an X, push the button. Right? So you're concentrating on X. A more complicated version of the continuous performance test involves a sequence. So every time you see an A that's followed by an X, you respond. So this is where kids with ADHD have a challenge because they tend to push the button whenever they see an X, even if it wasn't preceded by an A. People with schizophrenia make the opposite error. The A doesn't activate their attentional process to make them look for an X. When healthy people do the AX CPT, you can snooze your way through until you see an A. When you see an A, you wake up and you see if the next thing is an X. If the stimulus on the screen is a B, you know you don't need to respond to the next stimulus. And in its most complex version, the identical pair CPT, it combines a working memory demand with an attentional demand. Whenever you see the same stimulus twice in a row, you press the button. So if you see an X followed by an X, you'd respond, but if you see an X followed by a Y, you wouldn't. So you have to remember each stimulus
Right.
till the next one comes up, then forget it and make the response. This is what we talked about before. Working memory involves forgetting as well as remembering.
So how does this translate into day-to-day function? How does attentional problems interfere with the function of a young man with schizophrenia who's trying to get a job?
One of the subjective descriptions that people with schizophrenia will commonly tell you is it seems like there's too much information in the background, right? If you're sitting in class, the fact that there are so many people around you is so distracting, even though they may not be talking, they may just be sitting there, that you can't focus on what the professor says. So the idea is selecting attention is challenging. Another common subjective complaint is that I can't concentrate on something till I get to the end of it. So, like, I start watching a television show, and by the time the first commercial comes up, I've forgotten what it's about. And that's selective attention. Take that into the job site. Your boss tells you, okay, whenever the customer comes in, run up and greet them. But if you're so distracted by the people who are, if you're a Walmart greeter, if you're so distracted by all the people who are already there that you can't tell who's coming in or who's already there, you can't do that job. And if you are in a situation where you're working, say, in a manufacturing position, and your job is to do X every time an item comes down the assembly line, if you can't concentrate as to whether or not an item is new or not, you don't know whether you need to operate on it. So you see how both those things differentially could impact on vocational function.
Very nice example. So let's move now to another major cognitive function, which is executive function, what we call executive functions. Those are also impaired in schizophrenia. Can you tell us what they're like?
Yeah, executive functions, it's a complex term. Really what it means is reasoning and problem solving. So it's figuring out things logically and solving problems. Now, executive functioning highlights the fact that before we talked about how the frontal lobe manages working memory. Well, the frontal lobe manages reasoning and problem solving as well. So to solve a problem, you need to collect your information. You need to know how much information you need to make a decision. You need to know when you have that information, and then you have to use that information to make the correct decision. People with schizophrenia have a tendency to make decisions without using enough information. Another problem they have in reasoning and problem solving is failing to give up a bad strategy if it's not working. In the Wisconsin card sorting test, this is measured by a thing called a perseverative error. So if you know that a certain kind of choice is wrong, and you know it before you make your next choice, and you make that same choice again, that's called perseveration. That's different than not knowing what to do, so you respond at random to try to find out what to do. But when you use a strategy that you know is wrong again, then that's a challenge, right?
Yes. So impulsivity and perseveration are two functions and executive function, but there's also planning ahead and abstraction. I mean, those are also part of the executive function. Can you elaborate on those?
Yes. Back in the early days of research on schizophrenia, both Kreplin and Bleuler noticed that people with schizophrenia was in abstraction. So one of the ways they noticed that was by asking patients about similarities between different items. So if you ask someone with schizophrenia, how are an orange and a banana alike, they might say, they both have skins, or they're both things, rather than capturing the fact that they are fruits, that lots of things that aren't fruits have skins, and lots of things that don't even have skins or are fruits are things. So the idea, the level of capturing the critical level of analysis is challenging. So to know that work and play are both things that you do, rather than saying, oh, there's no relationship between them because you can't work and play at the same time.
Gotcha.
So that's abstraction.
I usually use proverbs for my patients. That's another way to test their, is it the same level, same type of abstraction, proverbs versus similarities?
Similarities and proverbs are quite similar. On the Wechsler Adult Intelligence Scale, they're placed on different scales. There's a whole scale of similarities. But then proverbs are included as well. And so very simple proverbs. A stitch in time saves nine might be interpreted by a person with schizophrenia as saying, you'd better have some threat around, right? Mm-hmm. Or something like that that doesn't capture the sort of larger abstract concept.
The meaning, yeah. All right, so does that
interfere? You talked about planning.
Yeah, does that concreteness also interfere with functioning in real life?
Absolutely, because what it does is it leads to a situation where it's very challenging to branch out and identify new relationships between things, right? So if you had a job working at a store and the manager wanted you to reorganize one of the aisles that had become slightly disorganized and wanted you to be able to put, for example, the salad dressings together, have them be next to the olive oil but not intermixed with the olive oil, you need to be able to tell that because a salad dressing is called an olive oil vinaigrette, that it's not the same thing as olive oil, right?
Right, right. Okay, good practical examples there. All right, well, what's the next major test, cognitive function that's impaired?
Well, you talked about planning for the future, and that's important as well. Because even on a fairly low level, so for example, yesterday you told me you'd like it if I'd wear a tie when I gave this talk. So what I did yesterday was I made sure that I had a shirt and a tie easily accessible that would work well on the video and not have to hunt around for them in the morning and be 2 minutes late for our conversation. So last night, I planned ahead. I've got plenty of shirts and plenty of ties, but sometimes they don't work on a Zoom call. So I was planning ahead for today's conversation, which made it much more simpler and efficient when we actually got started. I was ready on time and things like that. People with schizophrenia very often have challenges in getting organized and like getting to work on time, realizing that you need to set an alarm, maybe have your clothes ready for the morning, realize if you're taking the bus might be a little bit late, things like that. And that becomes a very big challenge.
Yes, yes. And sometimes they don't adhere to medications because they don't plan ahead and put the pill box and a bottle of water, you know, next to their bed, et cetera, et cetera. It's obvious that sometimes patients with schizophrenia have trouble making a decision about what to wear. You were giving that example about yourself. We have patients coming in the middle of hot summer wearing a winter coat. Okay, so they make the wrong decisions about even a simple thing like what to wear today.
Right, and so that's a very clear example of someone who says, well, you know, the air conditioning was high the last time I was there. I might want to bring a sweater, but the difference between a sweater and a winter coat becomes blurred, particularly if you're running out the door at the last minute to get your appointment. So that's really the collection of cognitive abilities. So it's attention, working memory, episodic memory, processing speed, and executive functioning. And there are debates about other things that are important, but you know, the idea is that many other subdomains of those global areas exist. So there's like spatial memory that may or may not be different than verbal memory. It may or may not be as important as verbal memory. But I think we've hit the main domains of cognition so far.